Good afternoon. The next item of business is portfolio questions. And portfolio this afternoon is social justice. At question number one, I call Paul O'Kane.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to bring down processing times for the adult disability payment in light of the most recent high-level statistics from Social Security Scotland indicating a reversal in the previous reduction to processing times.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Social Security Scotland have made a range of improvements which have significantly improved processing times, with decisions now being made over 30% faster than this time last year. Social Security Scotland are also getting decisions right first time, with only 11.7% of decisions resulting into a request for a redetermination. The workforce of the agency has managed flexibly to meet all client demand, and along with supporting new applicants, 200,000 people have now had their award transferred from the DWP, and recent statistics highlighted over 40,000 comprehensive reviews were carried out between April and July. Processing times for new applicants will be balanced against the need to support all clients and will continue to be monitored to ensure everyone is treated with dignity, fairness and respect.
Paul O'Kane.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? And members from across the Chamber welcomed the long overdue fall in processing times for ADP that we saw earlier this year. But it is concerning to see that that trend is reversing, because the latest statistics show that median waits have risen by almost 24% since April and are now back over 3 months. That's markedly above the original pledge for decisions to be made within 8 to 10 weeks before the target was removed from the Government's website. So I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, with the review of recruitment that we've discussed before ongoing at Social Security Scotland, what further assurances can she give to Scotland's disabled community that the Government are getting on top of this reversal and ensuring that waiting times will fall across all of the payments administered by Social Security Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Mr McCain's quite right to point out to the fact that he quite rightly asked me previously around the reassurances required about the recruitment levels and the recruitment freeze which the Scottish Government has, and I'm pleased to restate that reassurance that the recruitment freeze in no way affects those that are directly delivering the benefit decisions on behalf of whether it's disabled clients or anyone else, presiding officer. The workforce is flexible and it is managed flexibly, as I said in my original answer, and that's important that we have that flexible workforce within the agency to ensure that we're delivering for all clients. But I can assure Mr O'Kane that the agency continues to make improvements to the system to deliver good processing times, both for ADP and indeed other benefits.
Question number two, David Torrance, who's joining us online. Mr. Torrance. Mr. Torrance needs to uncover his camera, I'm advised. Mr. Torrance, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the implications of the UK Government's decision to reduce the winter fuel payment for the delivery of the winter heatment pay in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
The UK Government's decision to restrict eligibility for winter fuel payments was taken without consultation or discussion with the Scottish Government, and it has had a devastating consequence for our planned launch of pension age winter heating payment, reducing the fund available for our devolved payment by around £150 million. As a result, we have had to take the very difficult decision to mirror the approach in our pension age winter heating payment. However, this Government remains committed to continuing to press the UK Government to reverse its damaging decision, and we will, of course, keep every opportunity under review to make eligibility improvements in the future.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. Figures from SPICE show that as many as 13,700 pensioners in my Kirkcaldy constituency alone could be affected by this cut by the UK Government. Will the Cabinet Secretary outline what additional heating support low-income Scottish households can expect to receive this winter compared to the rest of the UK, despite the renewed austerity of the Labour Government in Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Mr Torrance is quite right to point out to the other support that is available to those on low incomes, including those pensioners on a low income receiving the eligible benefits. Unlike the UK Government's cold weather payment, for example, our winter heating payment guarantees a reliable annual payment of £58.75. This is only available in Scotland, and over 134,000 of the winter heating payments made last winter supported people aged 65 and over, an investment of nearly £7.4 million. This year, we are also spending £134 million to mitigate against the UK Government policies through discretionary housing payments and the Scottish Welfare Fund. And I was disappointed by the proposition that came forward from a Scottish Conservative member on Tuesday to follow what the DWP does on its cold weather payment, which would actually see us providing less money rather than more to pensioners across the country.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Freedom of information request by the Scottish Daily Telegraph newspaper has shown that the Scottish Government undertook no specific assessment on how many additional deaths would be caused by the decision to copy the Labour Party's decision to cut winter fuel payments. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if SNP ministers will now undertake an emergency impact assessment? And also, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm if ministers have considered deferring the block grant adjustment on the winter fuel payment this year so that ministers could actually make the payment to pensioners across Scotland this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, if Mr Briggs will forgive me, I will limit my remarks on the first part of his questions. He will be aware that this is a case that has live legal proceedings against it, so I will limit my remarks to saying that the impact assessments were published at the same time as the regulations were laid in Parliament. So forgive me, Mr Briggs, for not going into further detail on that. Mr Briggs will also be aware of the support that we continue to provide to households across the country, including pensioners, and that's a very, very important part of the work that we do.
And supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I asked this question on Tuesday, but I don't think I got an answer in terms of the additional supports the Government offers. Why did the Cabinet Secretary take the decision to cut the Fuel and Security Fund, which supports people, including pensioners? Why is the cold winter payment set at a standard rate in Scotland? And why has funding been repeatedly cut for energy efficiency standards? And why have the Government failed to pass on consequentials from the Household Support Fund? Why is that the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, there's a lot in that question, so if I can relate my remarks to one example of this. The standard rate which Mr O'Kane refers to is something which I alluded to in my original remarks. What Mr O'Kane is actually suggesting, if he also is wanting us to revert back to the DWP scheme, is actually to pay less money each year and to disinvest from our Social Security Fund. Now, surely that's not actually what Mr Kane is wanting us to do, but that is what would happen if we went back to reverting to the scheme which his government is now continuing on. When it comes to the issue of consequentials, I'm aware of the Labour Party's suggestions that there may be consequentials coming forward in the budget that could be used to support other pensioners. I can't base a budget on a wing and a prayer and a promise when, quite frankly, only a matter of weeks before the decision was taken to take £150 million out of the Scottish Government budget, I sat in a meeting with the Secretary of State for the Department for Work and Pensions, and no signal, no remote hint was forthcoming that a change was about to happen. So let's see what actually is in the budget from the UK Government, and then the Scottish Government will be able to make the decisions on their budget based on knowledge rather than on a promise.
Question number three. In fact, the member is unavailable due to committee business, which was approved by the Parliament, as the members will recall. I call question number four, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its social security policies are mitigating any impact in Scotland of the UK Government's so-called bedroom tax and benefit cap.
Cabinet Secretary.
This year we are making over £90 million available to local authorities to spend on discretionary housing payments to mitigate UK government policies, including the bedroom tax and the benefit cap. The benefit cap hits families the hardest, and the Scottish Government funding is helping to support around 3,400 families with over 11,000 children. Our bedroom tax mitigation policy is helping over 94,000 households with over 20,000 children. We are further supporting families by investing £457 million in the Scottish Child Payment this year. However, its impacts are greatly reduced by the UK Government welfare policies, including the inadequacy of universal credit.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. These policies are part of a UK regime that is a significant drain on the Scottish budget, a regime that is, also still includes the two-child policy and its abhorrent rape clause, and now cutting the winter fuel payment to pensioners. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the continuation of these repugnant policies show that only with the full devolution of Social Security policy will real change be achieved, and the culture of stigma and cruelty caused by the UK welfare system be brought to an end?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member is quite right to point to that stigma and cruelty that were felt by people during the DWP years, particularly with regards to disability payments. And I heard that once again directly from people when I visited the RNIB yesterday. It is absolutely critical that this government does what it can to mitigate against the worst excesses of the UK government was Tory, but unfortunately those policies are continuing under the Labour Party, and that's cost £1.2 billion within the 14 years. I gave Mr Sarwar the opportunity to agree with me that the bedroom tax should be scrapped, Presiding Officer, in a debate yesterday. It is disappointing once again to see that he did not take the opportunity to have that cross-party and collegiate working together.
Question number five, Ross McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how payments made by Social Security Scotland are incentivising people in Fife back into work.
Cabinet Secretary.
Social Security is an essential collective investment in the people of Scotland, which any of us could need at any time in our lives. Employment-related benefits such as universal credit are reserved to the UK Government, and we oppose the widespread use of sanctions, as overwhelming evidence shows clearly that they do not work to support people into stable employment. We launched the JobStart payment in 2020 to support young people from low-income backgrounds entering employment. And to the end of March 2024, we have paid almost £135,000 to people in Fife.
Ross McCall.
I fundamentally believe that creating jobs and getting more people back into the workplace is the best way to tackle poverty. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response and for highlighting JobStart. However, the employment rate in Fife has remained static for long periods, with almost a quarter of working age people currently unemployed. So that initiative is clearly having no impact in Fife. Yeah. So can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Scottish Government plans to invest in job creation in Fife so that thousands of people currently out of work have the opportunity to get back into paid employment? And how will the social security system adapt to ensure that work always pays?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's an interesting point, Presiding Officer, that Ros McCall brings, because it actually relates very much to the powers that we have that has been raised in another question. JobStart payment is delivered under further powers under the Employment and Training Act 1973. The powers had to be agreed by the UK and Scottish Parliament under Section 63 order under the Scotland Act 1998. Any changes to eligibility would require legislative change, even minor, and they would need the agreement of both governments. So what a pity, Presiding Officer, once again, that we have one hand tied behind our back. And if only we had the responsibility for all the powers up here rather than a bit part of it, we could actually do more, just as Ros McCall suggests.
Yep. Question number six, Finlay Carson.
Apologies. To ask the Scottish Government what its proposed timeline and target date are for the establishment of a leavers fund to support victims of domestic abuse to leave abusive relationships.
Minister Kilcap-Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I can confirm that the Scottish Government received the final evaluation of the fund to leave the fund to leave pilot from Scottish Women's Aid in August 2024. This will inform a wider assessment of the pilot, which is looking at how it delivered against its objectives and how it improved housing outcomes for women and or prevented their homelessness, and what lessons were learned during the pilot. The assessment stage is near completion, and we will then be in a position to set out the next steps.
Finlay Carson.
Presiding Officer, domestic abuse incidents, beg your pardon, across Scotland remain high, with nearly 62,000 incidents recorded in 22-23, according to Police Scotland stats. This equates to almost 170 instances of domestic abuse per day. In the case of Dumfries and Galloway, there have been a report of 50% increase in calls to local support services. Statistics show that around 23% of women become homeless as a direct result of violence or abusive behaviour. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's explanation as to why we've not got the so-called Leavers Fund, but I can encourage the Minister to bring that forward as soon as possible.
Minister.
I thank Finlay Carson for his supplementary question and highlighting the plight of women that are facing such atrocious circumstances in the face of domestic violence. Our Delivering Equally Safe Fund is providing £7 million this year to local women AIDS groups to support services for women and children. We have introduced provisions in the Housing Bill, which, if passed, will put a duty on social landlords to develop and implement a domestic abuse policy outlining how they will support their tenants who are at risk of homelessness, including protecting the rights of women to stay safe in their own homes. We will work closely with the housing and violence against women and girls sectors to develop statutory guidance to accompany this duty. And as I referred in my previous answer, as soon as the assessment stage is completed, I will be in a better position to update Mr. Finlay and everyone else.
And supplementary, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister say what we can learn and apply here in Scotland from the Domestic Abuse Safe Leave Act Northern Ireland 2022, introduced by then Green MLA Rachel Woods, which created an entitlement to 10 days of paid leave for victims of domestic abuse and for connected purposes?
Minister.
I thank Maggie Chapman for raising a very, very interesting point there. Obviously, I will need further time to do that, and I would welcome the two of us getting together to have further discussions around that.
Question number 7, Sue Weber.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to continue delivering social security provisions in light of reports that total spending on devolved social security in 2024-25 is expected to be around £1.1 billion higher than the funding received from the UK Government through the block grant adjustment.
Cabinet Secretary.
Despite fixed budgets and limited powers, we have transformed social security provision in Scotland, establishing a radically different system based on dignity, fairness and respect. We have introduced 14 benefits, and I'm proud that we are committing a record £6.1 billion this year for benefits expenditure. This is almost £1.1 billion more than the UK Government gives to the Scottish Government for social security, demonstrating our national mission to eradicate child poverty and our commitment to help low-income families with their living costs, support older people and enable disabled people to live full and independent lives.
Sue Weber.
The SFC predicts, Cabinet Secretary, that as things stand, social security spending will increase to £8 billion in 2028-29. And alarmingly, current figures show that Scotland's unemployment rate is rising, with over 120,000 people having never worked. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that when times are tough fiscally, it would be better and advantageous to invest in education and employment opportunities, which will not only support people back into paid work, where they can then apply and develop their skills, but would also boost Scotland's economy?
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I recognise the slight widening out of the original question, but I'm sure that Cabinet Secretary can, in responding to the theme of the original question, respond to the member.
I'd be delighted to, Presiding Officer, because I am genuinely astounded by this line of questioning, because what Sue Weber's actually suggesting that we do is take away money from poor children and their families, take away money from disabled people, or take away money from carers. That is what our benefits go to. They go to low-income people, they go to disabled people, and they go to carers. She might also want to have a word with her colleagues just the row in front of her, Ros McCall and Jeremy Balfour, who in one amendment during stage two of the recent Social Security Bill added £6 million to a policy. That was one amendment of many that were actually brought forward by the Conservative colleagues. So if we want to have a genuine discussion about how to support disabled people, how to support carers and how to support those on low income, can I suggest that perhaps a good starting point for Sue Weber would be to have a discussion with her in parliamentary group about whether she wants to support these people or not.
Yeah. And supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Research from the Trussell Trust recently found that 48% of people who receive universal credit ran out of food in the last month across the UK. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that, faced with an inadequate UK welfare system that has been devastated by the Tories and now by Labour, the Scottish Government's £1 billion spend above UK Government funding on social security is an absolutely vital investment in our people and our society?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Audrey Nicholl quite rightly points out that the social security expenditure is an investment in our people. It is a human right and it is an investment in our people. Now, we've had a discussion in the Chamber before about the level of expenditure on the Scottish Child Payment, for example. I believe it was a point that Mr Rennie has made to me in the past about the government shouldn't be proud of the fact that Scottish Child Payment is in existence. I'm not proud that that has to be there, but I am proud the government stepped up to support low-income people. So while the UK government does not, then this government will continue to support those who need us most.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I would advise members that question number 8 has been withdrawn, and I'm ahead of myself, and I would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary, and that concludes portfolio questions on social justice, and there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow those in the front benches to change position. Thank you.